Good morning, and a very warm welcome to the service of worship this morning. I trust that you have known the Lord's presence and his peace in this week that has passed. We come just for this time to seek to give our attention to the Lord, to look to him, to cast other distractions aside, and to worship him together. A couple of announcements to make before we begin. Just to say that for those who have filled in their Garda vetting forms, if I could just ask you, you would get an email in where you have to then complete a section online. So if I could just ask you to be aware and look out for that email coming through, even just to check your junk or spam email folder, just to check it hasn't gone in there as well. But thank you to all those who have filled out their Garda vetting forms and done their online parts of that process so far. Thank you. And also just to say, our Communicant Church membership classes start this afternoon at 2:30. So it's your last chance if you want to sign up for those, if you want to send me a message, if you do want to participate in those. Start at 2:30. If you're participating, you should have got the details through for the Zoom meeting for that. The psalmist writes, "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving devotion for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him." Let's take a moment of stillness just to focus ourselves on the Lord, to cast all else that might be going on in our minds aside, just to look at, and to focus on him as we come to worship him. Loving and Almighty Father, we pray you'd help us just to focus on you for this time of worship this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. We're going to sing a hymn now entitled, "Come, Now is the Time to Worship."
Time to worship. Come,
We're going to come to the Lord in prayer now. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we come to give you our praise and our worship this morning. You have done marvelous things for us, and we are glad. We rejoice in those. You are the source and the sustainer of our lives. All good things come from you. And you, Lord, you seek to draw us to you. Wherever and whoever we are, you are close. You surround us with your love. Though we forsake you, you do not forsake us. Though we fail you, you do not fail us. Despite our repeated faithlessness, still your faithfulness continues. Unchanged and undiminished. We come to you, Lord, very aware of our own brokenness and our own sinfulness. We are a sinful people living in a fallen world. Our natures are tainted by the sin that is part of our inherited human condition. And Father, if we are honest, we are often happy simply to dwell in our sin. We come now to you, Lord, in a moment's silence, to confess to you our sin and our sins of these past days. Father, we give you thanks and we rejoice that in Christ you have removed our sins from us, as far as the east is from the west. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you for your constant kindness, for your unfailing love, for your ceaseless provision of all our needs. We thank you for your mercy, your forgiveness, and your amazing grace offered to us in Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the joy, the hope, and the life that you have given us in him. We share together, Lord, in this time of worship, in deep gratitude that you, through Christ, have called us to be your people, that we are a kingdom people who are in your service. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. We now continue our series. We're doing a Bible overview at the moment, and we continue this series. And we're looking at Genesis 3 this week, the fall, as it is often known. And Carolyn Patterson is going to read this passage for us this morning. So if you have your Bibles, it would be great if you could follow along with Carolyn as she reads this morning. Carolyn, thank you.
Genesis chapter 3. Now the snake was the most cunning animal that the Lord God had made. The snake asked the woman, "Did God really tell you not to eat fruit from any tree in the garden?" "We may eat the fruit of any tree in the garden," the woman answered, "except the tree in the middle of it. God told us not to eat the fruit of that tree or even touch it. If we do, we will die." The snake replied, "That's not true. You will not die. God said that because he knows that when you eat it, you will be like God and know what is good and what is bad." The woman saw how beautiful the tree was and how good its fruit would be to eat, and she thought how wonderful it would be to become wise. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, and he also ate it. As soon as they had eaten it, they were given understanding and realized that they were naked, So they sewed fig leaves together and covered themselves. That evening they heard the Lord God walking in the garden, and they hid from him among the trees. But the Lord God called out to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden. I was afraid and hid from you because I was naked." "Who told you that you were naked?" God asked. "Did you eat the fruit that I told you not to eat?" The man answered, "The woman you put here with me gave me the fruit and I ate it." The Lord God asked the woman, "Why did you do this?" She replied, "The snake tricked me into eating it." Then the Lord God said to the snake, "You will be punished for this. You alone of all the animals must bear this curse. From now on you will crawl on your belly, and you will have to eat dust as long as you live. I will make you and the woman hate each other. Her offspring and yours will always be enemies. Her offspring will crush your head and you will bite their heel." And he said to the woman, "I will increase your trouble in pregnancy and your pain in giving birth. In spite of this, you will still have desire for your husband, yet you will be subject to him." And he said to the man, "You listened to your wife and ate the fruit which I told you not to eat. Because of what you have done, the ground will be under a curse. You will have to work hard all your life to make it produce enough food for you. It will produce weeds and thorns, and you will have to eat wild plants. You will have to work hard and sweat to make the soil produce anything until you go back to the soil from which you were formed. You were made from soil and you will become soil again." Adam named his wife Eve because she was the mother of all human beings. And the Lord God made clothes out of animal skins for Adam and his wife, and he clothed them. Then the Lord God said, "Now the man has become like one of us, and has knowledge of what is good and what is bad. He must not be allowed to take fruit from the tree that gives life, eat it and live forever." So the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden and made him cultivate the soil from which he had been formed. Then, at the east side of the garden, he put living creatures and a flaming sword, which turned in all directions. This was to keep anyone from coming near the tree that gives life. Amen.
Now, boys and girls, I wonder if you have one of these in your house. A biscuit tin. A biscuit tin. Most homes have a biscuit tin or a biscuit container of some kind. Now, I wonder if there's any rules in your house about having the biscuits now. In most houses, the rule would be, if you want to have a biscuit, you ask. You know, you ask. That's the rule. That's the rule in our house. That was the rule when I was a boy. You know, if you want to have a biscuit, you always asked. Sometimes, mostly the answer would be, yes, of course you can have a biscuit. But sometimes it would be no, because maybe you just had a snack, or maybe tea time was coming soon. Sometimes the answer would be no. But boys and girls, I wonder if ever, when there's nobody around and the biscuit tin is there, you think to yourself, I love a biscuit. Nobody's around. Nobody will know. Just one. Now, I would do that occasionally when I was a boy. Yeah, take a few biscuits. Nobody will notice. But boys and girls, we all have this inclination, don't we, to do sometimes just do the wrong thing. Do the thing that we're not meant to do. And this all started in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve ate the fruit that God had told them not to eat. Clearly told them not to eat. He had said, eat from any other tree apart from this one. But the serpent, the devil, convinced them, deceived them into thinking that this was okay to eat this. And we too, boys and girls, we can have this, almost this voice in our head that says, yeah, it's okay. Just one. Nobody will notice. It's all right. So we see our sinful condition. Because Adam and Eve sinned, we too are sinners. We have this natural inclination. But thankfully, boys and girls, it's not totally a bad news story. Jesus came and died for our sins so that we wouldn't have to suffer the punishment and the consequences of that sin. Now, I think we all know that if we do something wrong, it's right that there's a consequence. You know, if you take biscuits and you're not meant to, there'll be a consequence. If you're caught, there'll be a consequence, rightly so. And the same with our sin, there's a consequence. But we're very thankful that Jesus did come, that he took the punishment, that we don't have to. Let's take a moment to pray. Father, we thank you that even though we are sinners, even though we disobey you often, you sent Jesus to die so that we wouldn't have to take the consequences of that sin. Jesus has taken the consequences, and we're so, so grateful for that, Lord. So, so grateful. Help us to love you and to serve you in response to your goodness and love shown to us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, boys and girls, we're going to sing a song now. I think you know this one. Our God is so big, so strong and so mighty.
So big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. And the mountains are his, the valleys are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are his, the valleys are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are his, the valleys are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do.
Bring our prayers for others now. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that we have seen the first steps this week in a return to some normality, Lord. We're very, very grateful for that. Thank you, Lord, that we are heading in the right direction, Lord. We do long to get back to church, to get back to being able to socialize now, to see one another, Lord, again. We so long to get back to that. Lord, we thank you for the boys and girls getting back to school this week. And we just pray your hand of protection upon them, Lord. Keep them safe, bless them, help them in their schoolwork, we ask, that they would know your presence and your love, Lord. We pray for teachers as well, for principals, for our schools, that you will be blessing them all richly, Lord. Keeping them safe, Lord. Protecting them, that they would know your guidance and your help in these days. But Lord, we continue to remember the situation around the world with COVID, Lord. And we know that some places are very bad with it, Lord. We continue to remember Brazil, India. We continue to remember places in Europe like France and Germany, Poland, where things are getting worse, Lord. Oh, Lord, we pray that, again, the situation could improve in these places, Lord. That things could get better rather than worse, Lord. That lives would be protected and saved, Lord. That people would look to you, seek you in these days, Lord. Know that you are the only one who ultimately can save them and keep them safe, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that more vaccines have become available, Lord, in the EU, Lord. More vaccines available here. And we just pray that those could be administered quickly, Lord, and we could move forward quickly to be immunized against this virus, Lord. Father, we also want to remember in these days persecuted Christians around the world. We think of countries, Lord, where people will be imprisoned, maybe even killed, if they openly admit that they're a Christian, Lord. Oh, Lord, protect them. Keep them safe, we ask. And we pray, Lord, that there would be a greater and growing tolerance around the world towards Christians, Lord, and peoples of all faith. We pray, Lord, for those imprisoned at the moment in places like North Korea, Sudan, countries where it's just dangerous to follow you, Lord. Thank you for the faith of your people in these places. Thank you for those who are willing to follow Jesus, even with the potential risks and consequences that holds. Protect them, Lord. Keep them safe. Keep them close to you, we ask. Father, we also just want to remember those in our own community, those in our own congregations who are struggling at this time. We think especially of those who are grieving in these days, Lord, that you would give them your peace, help them to seek you and to know Christ's grace. We pray for those, Lord, who are simply anxious, worried, concerned, feeling overwhelmed by the worries of this world. May they seek you, Lord, and know your peace and your comfort in these days. Father, for all those who are simply far from you and lost, we pray, Lord, that you would make yourself known to them, that they might look to you, turn to you, and know your mighty hand of salvation upon them, Lord. Lord, you are a God who desires to bless. You are a God who desires that we know you and draw near to you, Lord. We thank you for that. We thank you for this time of worship that we have this morning. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. It would be great if you had your Bible open at the passage that we read, that Carolyn read for us, Genesis Chapter 3. Last week, in chapters 1 and 2 of Genesis, we saw that God had created the perfect world, his perfect kingdom, where he would dwell closely with his people. In Genesis 3, it all sadly starts to unravel. Now, there are so many questions that come into our mind, that could come into our mind as we read this chapter. Did it all really happen? Are there elements of myth in this story? A talking snake? Should we take this literally? Where did the serpent come from? How did it get into the garden? Where did evil originate? Some of these questions are more easily answered than others. Now, the New Testament does confirm for us that Adam was a real human being, that he was the first human. Revelation identifies the snake as Satan, the devil, who we understand is a fallen angel. Now, twice in the New Testament, we read of angels rebelling against God. But the writer of Genesis 3 doesn't set out to answer all the questions that we might have. They simply tell us what we need to know. We see distortion. The serpent seeks to distort the truth. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? This is a subtle questioning of God's words, seeking to distort what he had said, the one rule that he had given them. It, in many ways, seems like an unreasonable question. But under the surface, God has been painted as a spoilsport who says, you can't, to Adam and Eve. And this is a subtle distortion that we see here in Genesis 3. Satan is seeking to plant doubt in Eve's mind. Did he really say that? The inference is no, that's not what he said. Couldn't have been. Seeking to sow seeds of doubt. Eve corrects him. It is only the tree in the middle of the garden that they must not eat from. And then the serpent goes with a different tactic. Deception. You will not surely die. Now, this is outright deception, an outright lie. But Satan comes across as very reasonable and rational. It's almost as if he's saying, that's daft. It's never going to happen. Coming across as Mr. Nice Guy. Following that, he changes tact again and goes with a half-truth. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. And you will be like God, knowing good from evil. Now you might think to yourself here, what's so bad about knowing good and evil? Well, if you think about it, Adam and Eve, so far, at this time, only knew good. That's all they had experienced. They had no experience of evil. Why would they want to, really? They had known just good. But following this, they would know good and evil in their lives. Now, Satan didn't explain to them what knowing good and evil would look like for them. They would know the very real effects of evil in their lives. But perhaps it was being like God that appealed to them. Rather than being under the authority of God, the idea of being like God, equal with God, was perhaps appealing. Anyway, this half-truth from Satan, it was deceptive. It was deception. One of the things that I think is striking in Genesis 3 is how the tactics used by Satan to distort the truth and to deceive. We know these strategies. We know them in our own lives. We know this internal voice that seeks to distort the truth, which seeks to justify things and to deceive us. The way Satan tempts Eve, we can identify with it. We can verify that this is the way, yes, this is the way that the devil tempts. We know this tempting through our own experience. And one thing the passage certainly teaches us is to beware of Satan, beware of his subtle tempting. So the distortion and the deception led to disobedience. When the woman saw or perceived or thought that the fruit of the tree was good for food, pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom in her own mind, so she took some and ate. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he also ate it. They both knew fine well that God had said they must not eat from the tree. Yet they thought that they knew better. And did you notice the immediate results of their disobedience? They realized that they were naked, and they judged this to be bad. They became fearful and uncomfortable. They hid from the Lord as he walked through the garden. A significant change had occurred in them. Sin had entered them. Now they sought to play the blame game as to whose fault it was. The consequences were alienation from God. Work became demanding. Childbearing would be painful. Life became simply harder, more difficult. If you remember last week, God's perfect creation was characterized by a series of perfect relationships between God and humans, between male and female, between humanity and the earth. That all changed. It was broken. It had all become undone. God in his purity could not dwell with a sinful humanity. The intimacy that the man and woman had between themselves, it was diminished. They felt shame, but naked, even though it was just the two of them there. Their relationship with the earth became difficult and challenging. In addition, Adam and Eve's decision to eat the fruit from the tree brought death. It brought death into the world. Physical death. And this was certainly not immediate. Adam lived until he was 930 years old. But he died. Eve died. But also they died in another way. Now Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus, says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins." They died in a spiritual sense. They were alienated from God. They had consciously disregarded his instructions. They had believed the distortion and the deception. They had falsely believed that they could be equal with God and autonomous from him. Sin had entered the world. Like an infection enters the human body, sin entered into humanity. Now the final outcome of sin entering the world was death, both spiritual death and physical death. As we move through the next chapters of Genesis, we see the spread of sin and the spread of death. In chapter 4, the next chapter, we see the first murder, where Cain kills his brother Abel. In chapter 5, we see that following Adam, generation after generation faced death. They were mortal as a result of the fall. In chapter 6 to 9, we learn that the Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. God's just judgment was that humanity should be wiped out, with the exception of Noah and his family. But still, sin lived on through the line of Noah. And we see in chapter 11 that proud humans undertook to build a tower to reach the heavens. Vaughan Rogers writes, "The Tower of Babel is a vivid symbol of our sinful desire to exalt ourselves and create our own kingdom independently of God." It all stemmed from that moment in the garden. The history of humanity is clouded by the actions of our first parents. We have descended into a deep, deep darkness. Distortion, deception, disobedience, death. In an instant, the world had changed. How was it to be fixed? Now, the rest of the Bible tells that story. This is God's story about how he would fix what was broken, how he would reconcile what was torn apart, how he would restore his kingdom. Verse 15 is a key verse in Genesis 3. It points forward to the defeat of the serpent by a future descendant of the woman. And this defeat is implied by the serpent being bruised on the head, which is more serious than the offspring of Eve being bruised on the heel. And this verse is understood to be the first announcement of the gospel. He will crush your head. And this seems to refer to an individual, one particular offspring of Eve. Within the larger biblical context, this hope comes to fulfillment in Jesus, who is clearly presented in the New Testament as overcoming Satan, while at the same time being bruised. It is a promise of God's rescue, a promise of the destruction of the serpent and the suffering of Christ at Calvary. And this verse points ahead to how God is going to deal with the problems of sin and death that had entered his world. You know, it's interesting that when Jesus was tempted, Satan used exactly the same strategies against him. He sought to distort the truth, seeking to sow doubt, using half-truths, outright deception as well. But Jesus stood firm, constantly looking to and using God's word. Ancient cultures loved a champion. An example would be the story of David and Goliath. The champion represented the whole people. When David killed Goliath, the Philistines fled, regarding themselves as defeated. Now Adam is presented as the champion, the representative of mankind. But he was not victorious. He failed. And as a result of that, we live in a broken and sinful world. The nature we have is inherited. It is a sinful nature. We live with the consequences of the actions of our forefathers, the first humans. In Romans, we read, "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people, because all sinned." But thankfully, Adam is not our only representative. The New Testament presents Jesus as the second Adam. Now, he was victorious. He did not fail. As we read on in Romans, we read, "For just as through the disobedience of one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous." In our culture today, the idea that we are connected to Adam, that we are all sinners because of the actions of Adam and Eve, it's not a popular concept. We like to think of ourselves as autonomous and independent, but sadly that is not the case. We are all connected. We live in a broken and a sinful world. And scripture now in Genesis 3 clearly presents the reason why this is the case. To be human is to live in a world where death is prevalent. But by the grace of God, we do not have to remain members of the old humanity. We do not have to be eternally bound by sin and death. We have been given the option, the opportunity, to be part of a new humanity, a humanity which is not characterized by death, but by life. We're told in 1 John that the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. Now, the first and the primary work of the devil was in deceiving Eve and the resulting disobedience. The consequences for humanity were living in a world of sin and death. Jesus came to overcome sin and to defeat death. John Stott writes, "So then, whether we are condemned or justified, whether we are spiritually alive or dead, depends on which humanity we belong to. Whether we still belong to the old humanity initiated by Adam, or to the new humanity initiated by Christ, we have a choice as to who we will make our champion. Will it be Adam? Now, if we choose Adam, we continue in the distortion and the deceit of Satan. We choose continued disobedience and death. In choosing Christ, we choose truth, grace, obedience, and ultimately life. The believer's champion calls out to us, "Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." Who is your champion? Let's be still and reflect on God's word. Loving Father, we thank you that even though sin entered the world and has infected it ever since, you had a plan, Lord. You're working out that plan to rescue your people. You've created a new humanity, your people, that through Christ can know your forgiveness, can know the life that you offer, Lord, that we're no longer held, imprisoned by sin and death. But we have that promise of life in your kingdom forever, Lord. And we thank you for that. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that you sent a champion to rescue us, to save us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We close our service by singing together, "O Jesus, we have promised." May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen.